represent, Myra. There you go. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, gang.
We're going to have some fun today.
And some coffee.
And some coffee, because yesterday was International Coffee Day, in case anybody missed that.
I didn't miss it. Every day is International Coffee Day for me.
That's what I always say. Myra, what's in your cup this morning?
What am I working on this morning?
No, what's in your coffee cup?
Oh, I was going to say I'm working on my coffee. Bustelo.
Sounds like a lovely drink.
I only drink Puerto Rican coffee.
I'll bet it's fantastic. You'll have to bring me. Can I buy, like, is that import, special import, or can I buy it here?
Okay, Brent, so Puerto Rico is part of the United States of America. I am a citizen, and you can get Puerto Rican coffee here. Now, I'll bring you some.
It's not always that easy.
I'll bring you some.
Jeez, Willikers.
Some things get complicated sometimes. Angela has made a comment already about the shirts. So let's take a second and show off the shirts. I'm feeling like a loser today.
You didn't get the memo, but that it's T-shirt day, Chris.
Apparently not.
All right. So mine says I woke up like this. It is from T-Chip, and it was gifted to me. But yeah,
I love the unicorn with the cup of coffee. That's nice.
Yep.
I was expecting to see it farting rainbows, because isn't that like the unicorn meme these days?
Oh, that's on my phone case that's upstairs.
Beautiful. Well, mine is a local coffee shop. I had a local artist do a coffee heavy metal T-shirt.
Oh, I love it. Is that a brain?
Coffee. Rock on.
Is it a brain though, Brent?
No, it's just a skull.
Oh, okay. I thought it was like a brain exploding.
Your standard skull and fire and Metallica font spelling coffee.
Woo! Anyway.
Holy smoke. I guess we better talk about something related to instructional design, or else people are going to start bailing on us.
I don't know. We can talk about coffee. I'm sure everyone here could really use a stiff drink of coffee, right?
Indeed. There must be something instructional about it, I would say. I would say, how could anybody possibly learn without first a nice jolt of coffee?
So did you know that coffee stimulates your brain and allows you to learn a little bit better? So if you do a test and you try to study without coffee and then study with coffee, you know, your mood is enhanced and your breathing improves, and it's scientifically proven.
It is. It is on Maslow's hierarchy of needs for sure. There's one line right in that one spot. It's hard to read, but it says must have coffee.
That's right. Good one, Mark. That's nice. Excellent to throw that in there. So let's introduce. I mean, we already rambled on a bit, but let's introduce today's guest. It's me, Myra.
Woo!
Hey, it's Myra. I feel like Myra should have her own theme song. But anyway.
Oh, every time. I'm on it.
Brent's on it. And by the end of the episode, we'll close with Myra's theme song.
Why is it going to be that quick?
Madly Googling. Anyway. Myra, we'll get you to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about yourself.
Then
we'll move on to the official topic for today, which is, surprisingly, not actually coffee as a topic.
Okay. And I will try to throw coffee in there as part of my research. So first of all, I'm a huge Queen fan. So just know anything Queen as my theme song works. Hi, everyone. Good morning. I'm Myra Roldan, and I am a program manager at Amazon in a small program called AWS Educate. And We're an organization that provides, we're part of Amazon. We are in the AWS family, and we provide educational resources to educational institutions K through 20, so kindergarten through PhD programs. And we focus on cloud computing. And so part of my job and what I do is I work with universities. I'm in the higher ed section, and I work with universities to help them figure out how to integrate new skills into their curriculum. So, and everything maps to jobs. So I work backwards from jobs, which means I do a lot of labor market research. I do a lot of reading. I do a lot of finding weak signals and finding commonalities to identify core skills that someone needs to be proficient in their job. So that's me in a nutshell. Oh, and if you didn't get it, I'm from Puerto Rico. I am in Seattle. Represent.
And it is slowly becoming dawn in Seattle at the moment. We can see the light brightening behind you.
Light's coming in. And so I'll become lighter and lighter.
You definitely needed the coffee this morning to get rolling. So, yeah. And we have this awesome title, which I almost think of as like a horror movie. Rise of the Hybrid Instructional Designer.
Yeah.
In a world where instructional designers, anyway.
I love the voice.
I'm not doing so well. I should have maybe practiced ahead of time.
The resident voice actor at dominKnow, yes.
No kidding. No kidding. But we were talking a little bit about before we went live about, you know, some of the things that you're digging into the research and watching patterns, et cetera. And some things that you're seeing, which has kind of led to us having this title for today's session. That I guess my subtext or my subtitle thought was the times they are a changing. You know, for the role that so many of us do. So maybe tell us a little bit about, you know, some of that stuff that you've been looking into and you've been finding as you've been doing your work.
So, you know, and I go on rants on LinkedIn. So if you guys follow me on LinkedIn, you know, I do Myra Monday and I post a question, of the, it used to be of the day and it's turned into like of the week because the conversations just keep on going. And I've moved that into LinkedIn too. And it's just really interesting because I get a lot of people that reach out to me, who ask me like, can you mentor me? Or I'm looking to move into an instructional design role. I am a web developer, or I'm a business person, but I have these unique set of skills. How do I enter like that industry? I also get a lot of people who ask me like, how can I, increase my skills? How can I upskill and gain new skills? Like, what is a good path to learn how to program or learn data science or learn, I don't know, how to do good assessment or learn how to do data visualization? And so it's really interesting to me because, one, I feel like everyone thinks that I have like this magic ball, right? Like this, and I can be like, yes, this is what you need to do. Exactly. Right. And I know like my magic ball. and I don't have all the answers because, you know, actually even my role has changed dramatically as, you know, in instructional design since I started. And I've been in the industry. I'm like a dinosaur. I've been in the industry for a long time. And I share my background. So I'm a former systems engineer. So I have a technical background, and I rolled into the learning industry, which is, and you'll see that there are a lot of people, you know, where they're like, I was an English teacher, or I studied journalism, or, you know, I'm a history teacher. So we have a lot of people in the education sphere. Space that roll into instructional design. I taught for 30 years. I'm a, you know, college professor. And so all of that and all of the research that I've been doing for like my real job, like I focus on cloud computing and try to figure out because it's a new role and it's creating this hybrid type of employee because it doesn't mean that anyone going into cloud computing needs to be like fresh cloud computing and that's all you need to know. Like, you know, I have like network engineers that need to be able to manage a virtual network that's ran in the cloud, or a systems engineer, or a data scientist needs to know it. So there's all these roles that need to know cloud computing. So it creates hybrid roles. That led me down the rabbit hole of instructional design, right? Because I was like, okay, so this is cool. Like all these jobs have these hybrid skills. What does that mean for us as, you know, the learning and development space? And so Brent, you know, ATD has a model. So I'm going to share this with you. So let me see if I can share really quick. Oh, yeah. I'm going to share my Evernote. Let me see. Is this going to work? Because I'm dysfunctional today.
I'm sure everybody, while you're doing that, I'm sure everybody in the chat has kind of felt like you need to know a lot of different things. Why don't you guys drop into the chat? You know, what are some of the areas that you kind of feel like are valuable to you as an instructional designer that add value to the work that you do?
Yeah, so that would be interesting. Like this is ATD's competency model. They haven't updated this since 2014, right? So, and if you know, the speed of technology changes everything. Like yes, the skills you needed yesterday changed dramatically today. And so these are the kind of in the site. So it's I'm just using Evernote, and I love Evernote's web clip.
Yeah.
So this is, however, when you think about skills, with D and their skills, I created this chart here. Let's see if I, okay. So these skills, and can you guys still see my screen where it has hybridized competencies?
Yep.
Okay, cool. These, let me see if I can make this a little bit. Guys, it is like 7 a.m. here, so pardon my.
Oh, come on, man.
So okay, so
been up
here
an hour ago at least.
I know. So these competencies in bold are the core competencies, right? The competencies in the darker gray are like nice to haves, and these foundational competencies are supposed to be competencies that we all have. However, it's hit or miss, right? With depending on where you're at, because you may not be able to flex like your global mindset or your business skills or your industry knowledge. So unless your employer is giving you the ability to flex these skills, they're not really foundational skills, right? And the same here. So we all use learning models, do some instructional design, so we know how to design and develop. We can do some training delivery, especially when we think about like training delivery and, you know, learning technologies and evaluating learning impact. I would say that's a gray area for a lot of people. But then what I did is I scraped, I wrote a Python script and I scraped some job listings in LinkedIn, Indeed, and Monster around instructional design, e-learning developer, training managers, and I forget what the other one was. I told you, Brent, what was it? I did four. I won't put you on the spot because you weren't paying attention.
I don't remember. I did not commit them to memory. I'm sorry.
But what I did is I found like these, what else are employers looking for? And so this is just a short list in the orange of additional skills that I found really, really interesting, that a lot of employers are putting storytelling in there as a skill that they're requiring. Yeah, which is really interesting to me, because I would say that falls under communication design, but they're calling it out separately. So they're saying it's a skill we want specifically. We want you to be able to story tell.
That is interesting that it's starting to show up. I mean, I know we've been talking about it as an industry at events, lots of blog posts on it, we've even been talking about it on IDIODC. Mm-hmm. And for it to finally start showing up is really interesting. So I think one of the things that I wanted to talk about today too, and I don't want to steer this off track too much, but there's been a lot of stuff shared on LinkedIn and on Twitter that I've seen recently, it's bubbled up to the surface more so than I think in a long time. And that's the fact that whenever there are jobs out there listed for our industry, it's like they list like this superhuman that should have all of these skills, and that person doesn't exist. So, I'm sure you ran into that from your Python script. I mean, is that legit, or is it really just them throwing a broad net?
No, it's becoming legit, right? So I'm going to do this really quick. Let me just create a link to this, and I'll share it with everyone.
And then I guess my second question would be then, because people are really freaked out by it, and it's kind of turned into a joke, but if it's legit and we do need to know all the things, it's a bit depressing. So how do we go about getting all of those skills? Because somebody like you and me and Chris, you know, we've been in this industry for a really long time. You kind of pick up this stuff along the way just because we're interested in it and we know it's a part of what we do, right? So we do get interested in storytelling. We do get interested in basics of communication design. We do learn a little bit of code just because you sort of have to at a certain point. Project management, you know, you get into XAPI because you like getting into the authoring tools, you know, so over time you build up this thing, but then the job description also says only 3 years of experience required and we'll pay you, you know, $40,000 a year. And you're like, what?
So it was interesting. So Kevin Thorne posted. So you guys know Kevin Thorne, right? Like he is a phenom, yep. Right? He is a phenom. He is a thought leader. He's awesome. So he posted about like he was looking through jobs and he was kind of freaked out about the skills that employers are asking for, right? And so then I went in and I looked at like what is he seeing that maybe I didn't see. And you're right, they're looking for, and this is where the hybrid instructional designer comes in, right? So we're being hybridized. So which means the impact, when you think about the impact, it's not only it impacts us greatly, right? But if you're an instructional designer with industry experience, you have the ability to specialize. Like you can say, okay, I'm going to specialize just in data analysis. That's going to be my superpower that I'm going to bring in along with my instructional design skills. Or I'm going to learn how to program in a language and I'm going to bring that in as my superpower. Or I'm going to specialize in like visual design because you really can't learn it all, right? But when it comes to the programs that are creating the pipeline for these new instructional designers, right? They're getting freaked out because when they go on the market, they're like, wait, I didn't learn any of this. I don't know how to program. I don't know data analysis. I don't know XAPI. I don't know, you know, multimedia. I don't know emerging tech. I don't know. So they're getting freaked out because they're the ones who are getting really hit with those roles where they're saying you need to have XYZ and you need to know how to code and you need to know how to do this other stuff and you need 1 to 2 years of experience and we're going to pay you 40 grand, right? So I think the institutions that are creating these pipeline of instructional designers need to look at their programs and start figuring out how do they hybridize those programs to teach some of these skills. And I mean, and for us, right, who are already in the industry or trying to get into the industry, we just need to figure out like what's going to be our niche because when you have a niche, you make yourself marketable and but you need to be able to sell yourself too. So.
Yeah. Mark's posted a question in the question and answers panel. Crystal ball aside, are there areas of specialization in ID that you see being in the most demand in the next 2 to 5 years and beyond?
Programming. And that's not an ID skill, right? so let's talk about this. So a lot of what I do is I use Webb's Depth of Knowledge with the colleges. So I help them and I use that. Are you guys familiar with Webb's Depth of Knowledge? There's 4 levels.
No. No.
No. Oh, no. No.
I'm not competent.
No. No. So luckily, right, you don't need to be competent. And it's just like another measurement. Hold on, let me pull this up really quick. So Webb's Depth of Knowledge is just basically, think about entry level, intermediate level knowledge. And I'm just going to Google this and let's see if I can pull this picture up.
And master.
I'm glad to hear this because not having competence is actually my area of specialization.
So. I conscious love
incompetence
it.
Is my specialty.
Okay, so I'm going to dump this this link into the chat because someone needs to on a specific skill. So it goes from level one, which is recall. Level two is like being able to apply. Level three is like strategic thinking and reasoning. So like thinking through a problem and coming up with like, this is the approach we're gonna take. And then extended thinking is like that complex reasoning. And that's a lot of experimentation. So I'm at the point in my career where I'm expected to operate at a level four. Right, because I'm a dinosaur. So if I can't operate at a level four, which is that extending thinking, like thinking through complex problems and trying to experiment and see what works, and it would really hurt me to not have that knowledge, right? And so when you think about these hybridized skills. When employers are asking for like programming and all this other stuff, they're not expecting you to write a full API, an application programming interface. They're not expecting you to write a full API. What they're expecting you to be able to do is like use some code snippets that maybe you find or can write yourself, like small, like 30 lines of code. You understand what's going on in the code, or you're able to read code. Not necessarily, it's like learning a new language, right? It's like, can you read it and understand what's going on there so then you can help them make good business decisions? The other one is visual design. And with visual design, you guys know this whole thing around like design thinking and visual design are two separate things. And I've had people tell me like, I use design thinking. I'm like, yeah, that's different than visual design. Like, right?
I made this PowerPoint slide by doing design thinking.
Yeah. Visual design, there's so many nuances around it. That's a huge area of specialty, right? Like it's UX design, and it's understanding like accessibility and understanding like the cognitive load of like what you see on a page and stuff. I suck at UX design. Like I will tell you that.
You've got too much on this one right here, the hybridized idea. It's just far too many words for me. I think
I think of it, and Carolyn was asking, I don't mind learning new tools, but am I expected to be a programmer? And I think what you're reinforcing here, Myra, is that you've got to know enough to be able to converse with other people who have those areas of to be able to that might be producing something. Not unlike maybe, mm-hmm. Knowing enough about visual design and Photoshop, et cetera, to be able to communicate successfully to someone. I'm not going to open up Photoshop typically and do a lot of work it myself, but be able to explain, and communicate effectively, I guess, within that body of knowledge.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's just really interesting. Then, so I'm seeing in the comments, like, so Deborah's saying, it seems that the new term is learning experience design. We're going to see learning engineer come up soon. So learning experience is going to evolve into learning engineering. And I say, don't get hung up on titles.
Yeah.
Do not get hung up on titles. Because the moment you get hung up on your title, you're focusing on the wrong thing. Right? Like, who cares what they call you? If they call you an ID, if they call you a learning experience designer, if they call you an e-learning developer, the skill set may be a little bit different between an e-learning developer and an ID, right? Title means nothing. The title in most organizations, the title means it's just a way of classifying you, of putting you in a bucket that identifies that you fall into a certain job family. So I'll give you a perfect example. So at Amazon, there is no instructional designer role. We have instructional designers, right? Instructional designers fall under the program manager role. So think about that, right? So Titles are just a categorization that organizations use to bucket you, and that's how they kind of figure out your pay and your levels and all that other stuff.
Yeah.
Where you need to really focus is on what skills am I going to be really, really, really good at, right? So I can bring value and show that value in an organization. So my whole, I'll tell you, like, you need to know your strengths too. So I know that I'm a people person, and I know that I'm really good at building relationships, and I'm good at selling people on things and getting people and like selling my ideas, right? And so when I look at these competencies, I specialize in knowledge management, right? And knowledge management and change management, because that requires me to get buy-in from executives and people in higher positions, right? And I have to earn trust, and they need to have confidence in me. And then to that, I bring my technical skills, right? And I bring this whole not being afraid to take risks, right? Because I will try anything. And if it fails, it's like, oh, okay, that didn't work. Let's keep on going. I don't get hung up on, oh, geez, I'm going to lose my job because I failed in this one thing. And now I'm just like, I'm a failure. You know, that is never, failure is not a word in my vocabulary. It's like, if something didn't go the way I wanted it to, I will caveat and say, like, this is a test.
Yeah,
we're Barb, testing this.
Barb says, is this an agile environment? Yeah, yes, it is. We are agile all the time.
Perpetual yeah. beta.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I think and so
that you mention all of this. And I think, I guess it's a long-term journey, and it's a long-term process when we're looking at all this. And I think that's where sort of the cognitive disconnect comes in, when we know that we've gathered a bunch of these skills over a long period of time, but then to all of a sudden see a job posting that sort of minimizes that collection of experiences and knowledge that took so many years, it feels a little insulting, really. And I think that's where the frustration comes in, because like you said, people ask you, you know, they think you have a crystal ball, and they think, you know, oh, you know, just tell me that one new thing that I need to learn, and then tell me where I can go to learn it. Give me the 6-week course, then I get the certification, and then I'm going to go get the job, right? And it just doesn't work like that, really. For me, I always tell people, just what are you interested in? Like the new hybrid instructional designer just means there's this whole list of things that you should have basic understanding and knowledge of. And if you love being a teacher, if you love being an instructional designer, if you love what you're doing, all of these different things should interest you to some degree, I would think, and that you would go out on your own and you would kind of learn a little bit here, learn a little bit there, learn a little bit of this, and, you know, and look for opportunities to implement that knowledge or blend the two together and start to see how they relate to each other, right? Like you used your coding to gather a bunch of data to do research and analysis. You know, Chris and I were, you know, laughing when you first mentioned it to us before we went live. Oh yeah, she just whipped up a Python script just like that and got all this data. But that's because of the journey you've taken in your whole entire career. We're not saying, hey, everybody, go out there and take a 6-week course in Python and, you know, become fairly competent at it so you can whip together a little Python script to do this kind of stuff. Maybe if that experience exposes itself to you, great, go for it, you know, and learn it. And then, boom, you've got another little skill to add to your stuff. But I don't know. It's a difficult conversation, and I think that's why there's so many people here trying to figure it out.
Yeah. So let me share something, a secret with all of you. Employers do not know how to write job descriptions, right? So you think about people who are writing those job descriptions, they are pulling from like, yeah. So what? So hey, so remember that job you posted? Can you share that with me? Because I have an opening and I need some of those skills. And then I'm just going to throw in like a bunch of other things in here because I need to get this posted today. Right. Mm-hmm. So people that are posting those jobs aren't thinking through and they're not spending weeks and months trying to think of like, what is the perfect description for this job? And what do we want? No, they're throwing everything in the kitchen sink in there. And so a lot of times we tend to try and want to check all the boxes. Right. And if we don't check almost every single one of those boxes, or if we don't check every single box, we then feel that we're not qualified for the role. And I can't tell you how many roles I have obtained where I checked maybe one box, right? Where I was like, I know that I'm going to apply, right? Like, and I've gotten the role. So
there's a couple of questions we should probably jump to in the question and panel. Peter is asking, if you find someone with solid technical skills and an interest in training, so coming from that technical and working towards training, what are the first three instructional design skills they should seek to learn? What do we think about that, gang?
Yeah, I would say learn first three instructional design skills is like if you already have some kind of you're coming like from a programming background, you already know about personas. So you know when you're coding, you're creating for a specific persona because you have the technical requirements. So you know who you're coding for. That translates into instructional design. Learn how to, like, you already have design skills. So like if you're coding, you have to create your design and put it through an approval process and have like peer reviews. Same thing in instructional design. I would say learn an authoring tool and then learn like an instructional design process, right? Like a learning model. And everyone says Addy sucks. It's just too complex and too slow, but it's a standard. Every job posting you see out there says like an understanding of the Addy model, right? So just learn what that means. It doesn't mean like you have to use every single step in the Addy model, but learn what it means. And I can tell you most instructional designers specialize in design and development. Mm-hmm. They don't do any needs assessments. Very few do evaluation and very few do implementation, right? So if you learn the design and development piece, which you already have, if you have coding skills, because you have to create your design documents before you can code something. If you're working in a structured environment that requires that, right? And you should be, because especially if you're pushing code out to a public environment, because you need to know about security and you need to know about all that other stuff. So you're bringing like great skills to the instructional design environment. And then learning how to manage people. And when I say manage people, I don't mean like being a manager of people, but being able to manage relationships and communication. Like, right.
Yeah. So. Let's flip it backwards. Christine is asking, are there certain skills that you think are obsolete that might have been relevant 5 years ago?
Yeah, let's flip the script on the conversation.
Skills that are obsolete. So that's an interesting one, right? Because when you look at these jobs, they're still asking for a lot of these skills, the traditional skills, right? So they want us to have... Oh, do you have one, Brent? Go ahead.
Burning CD-ROMs.
Yes. Okay. Yes. You no longer have to burn CD-ROMs. I think about it. So most employers want you to have the traditional ID skills, but they also want you to have like, plus, you know, but wait, there's more.
The cutting edge, but yeah. We can't let go of the basics. Yeah. And then, sorry, I'm scrolling down here. Deborah's asking, can you talk about trends, gamification versus virtual reality? And I think there was some discussions in there, but are those skills different from instructional design? And I got to think partly that, this is an area where, you know, if gamification is there, you need to know enough to be able to talk about it, to understand it and communicate about it, for instance, as well as, you know, virtual reality. But if you're working within those areas and it's still making something instructional, then, yeah, all your baseline instructional design skills are still going to play a role in that.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I posted to her that, you know, the core skills needed around gamification and virtual reality are different, you know, because gamification, you need to know like game mechanics, and you need to know like kind of like the metacognitive aspects of that, right? And with virtual reality, you're thinking about the design portion of it, like virtual reality, you're thinking about impact, you're thinking about cognitive load, you're thinking about the technical, like, can we pull this off in this technical arena, right? I would also say specialize. Right. So I know some of you know that virtual reality has been kind of my shtick. Right. And I still play around in VR. Gamification, not so much. Like, I love games and I apply some game mechanics. I understand enough about game mechanics. Right. But it's vastly different.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not a game designer.
I dropped in the chat. You mentioned Kevin Thorne, so I would be remiss if I didn't mention spending a week with Kevin Thorne and Dr. Carl Kopp and Deborah Thomas and a few other folks learning game design and using game design to create instruction. And it was really, I mean, I'm a dinosaur too, just like Myra, been around a long time, and I refreshed my memory on a lot of things and learned a lot of stuff that I didn't know I needed to learn. And so when we talk about this kind of stuff and when people ask, you know, just understanding sort of the analog process of game design, if you take yourself out of the tech world for a minute and try to just do analog, it applies. Obviously, it transfers over to the digital, so you don't have to worry about it, right? Once you learn the process and figure out how to solve instructional problems using game design thinking, the way Carl Kopp talks about it, It opens up a whole new process model for you. And is it, still kind of ADDIE-ish? Yes, it's great. So learn ADDIE too. Great. Understand it and know it. But thinking like a game designer is hugely beneficial when I think it's going to be a big deal in the future. And it incorporates all of that cool stuff, all the storytelling, you know, solving a business problem, understanding game dynamics and core dynamics, and getting, you know, how do you engage people, right? We talk about, oh, boring e-learning, you know, click next. There's ways to use design and game thinking to create very, very simple experiences, but are wholly engaging. And I think we've lost that. And so I think the game design world is bringing that back. And I think that's what's exciting about it. It's not, hey, can you build a Jeopardy game in your local authoring tool? Mm-hmm. It's how to think like a game designer to build instruction. And it's a totally different thing.
I think we're going to see, we're going to see a lot of angry geese involved in gamification over the next year.
Angry geese. So, and you know what so when you think about that, right, like you're talking about like game mechanics and stuff like that, and you just said become a game designer. Think of what you just said, right? Like game design is a whole different realm, right? And that becomes very, like, for a lot of people, that's like, oh my gosh, so now I got to learn like game design. And again, we need to be careful, and we just need to stress that you don't need to become a game designer, right? You need to know.
You need to decide, and
you also need to decide what's going to be your specialty, because you can't be a master of everything. I can tell you, I am not a master. I'm a master of nothing, right? I know a lot of things, and I've mastered like one or two, but I'm not a master of everything.
A highly experienced generalist.
Yeah. And so someone posted a question that really jumped out at me. It's just like, Jennifer, I hear this a lot with my K-12 work. Why learn it when you can find it? Mm. That to me, and I couldn't find Jennifer's question as I was scrolling through, because this is just like, it's a lot of conversation going on. This whole idea of like, why learn it when you can find it? Think about this. From a learner perspective, right? This is where our challenge is that how many of you learn things on YouTube? Like, just show hands in the comments. Just a yes, right? How many of you, I learned how to replace a starter on my fireplace by watching a YouTube video. I learned how to bleed my furnace by watching a YouTube video where I was like, I'm going to blow up the house, but we're going to try this.
Don't light up a match right now, people.
I know. I was like, I would tell my kids, like, please leave the house. I'm going to bleed the furnace. right. But then think about, like, how many people have been like, how many times have you looked up, like, how to write a good email, or how to Word, you know, document, or how to create a design document, or how to, like, we're looking for templates, right? So we are bombarded daily with so much information, and our brains can only retain a small amount of information, right? So I always say, like, that's where you have to decide what are you going to specialize in, right? You don't need to know it all. You just need to, like, you know, kind of figure out, like, what's really focused your attention on, and then the rest is just you can look it up, right? If it comes up. And once you get in a job, like, you'll know, like, what exactly is it that you need to, they're expecting you to do. So they created this, like, superhuman ID role, and you get that role, and then you go in, they're like, yeah, create a couple PowerPoints. You're like, but wait, I thought I needed to code. And they're like, no, we just need some PowerPoints.
You know what I mean? I was just going to say, that after you've gotten one of those jobs that lists all that stuff out, and you're thinking, wow, I'm getting into the coolest job ever. And then they go, okay, here's all these PowerPoint slides. I want you to make them look pretty and put them into that cool authoring tool. And then we're going to push them into our LMS. That's really all we need you to do. And you're like, wow, that job description made it sound so much cooler.
Yeah.
I'll clarify something quickly on the game design thing. I hope I didn't make everybody think out there that they need to become a game designer. I've been really interested in it for a long time, and I've read all the books. I've read Carl's books. I've read other people's books. I've booked game design speakers. Eric Zimmerman is a fantastic game design theorist. There's a whole bunch of great thinkers out there. Read all the blog posts. All of that, but I'd never built a game before. Like, I've done game stuff on using templates and authoring tools and whatnot, but never sat and gone through the process from idea to creating a product. And that, just doing that process in a very simple way in a card game, was a really eye-opening for me. And so I wouldn't consider myself now all of a sudden a magic game designer, but going through the process and just cranking through the creative process in general was amazingly powerful. And I was not expecting it to be like that at all. And so I would encourage everybody, you got to do it. It's one thing to read about it and be interested in it, but you got to figure out a way to engage somehow and just go through the process. Again, you don't have to be an expert, just experience doing it.
I think that part of it is, like, you're putting that fear away, testing the waters of something new. And as soon as you start sort of digging into something, you're gonna see other connections to things that you already do. You're gonna also see opportunities to do things, you know, differently as well. But unless you are reaching out towards some of these other skills and starting to dig in a bit, you're missing opportunities then to change and to expand and to grow.
And that's really talking about, the hybrid instructional designer. Our future role is going to require us to be taking all of these different areas, these different concepts for the people that we serve, and telling them and helping them learn different and new things, and pulling together interesting combinations of things and utilizing those to educate and to train and to get that next generation workforce up to speed. We need to change too, but our jobs are going to be very quickly becoming everybody leaning on us to spin up the rest of the workforce as well. Mm-hmm. We're in interesting times.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. That's probably a good place to roll the music. Brent, did you find Myra's theme song yet?
I did not, but I'm going to find a special one for the next time she's on.
Excellent.
I'll find a good Puerto Rican tune for you.
In the public domain.
in the public domain. But no, this is totally fun. Myra, how can people get a hold of you?
So I am LinkedIn and Twitter. Throw my if I can remember it.
Awesome. You guys are great. Thanks for joining us. Chris, what do we got coming up? We're doing some cool things, aren't we?
Us? No, never. DevLearn, if you're going to DevLearn, join us for the live idiotic episode there on the Wednesday morning as usual. We can throw the deets maybe if we've got that sort of ready to copy paste. If you're in the Ottawa area or Eastern Ontario or even Northern New York State, come join us on October 17th here at the office. We're doing a getting started in video morning of learning for folks free. We've been sending out info about that. So that's a couple of cool, awesome things that we have underway.
Awesome. Yeah. So let's get everybody out at DevLearn for, we're going to go live and let's do that. That'll be fun on the Wednesday morning of DevLearn.
It's going to be tough. Bring your dancing shoes.
Yeah.
Or at least your dancing shoulders.
Let's dance out of here, people. Thanks, everybody.
Awesome. Thanks, everybody.
Bye, everyone.